wages that allotments actually bring to people. And it's a fabulous thing for families particularly to be able to take part in. But if we haven't got the provision, and I did ask a question a couple of months back on this, you recall the scheme, the incredible edible world schemes, and we started off in Tarnwood, and it must be about 10 years ago now that we tried to literally get that off the ground in Wirral. Now clearly it doesn't increase the provision of allotments, but it does perhaps address some of the issues, you know, particularly health benefits and people getting out and planting and growing. It seemed to be a really successful scheme in other parts of the country. Is there any thought that we might be able to supplement the lack of provision with some initiative along those lines again?
And the price. closed and had never been used for anything else. And it just lying waste, so I cite the example of the allotments in Mayor Karl, which you residents have contacted us and yourselves on numerous occasions to say they want them back. And I wonder what plans there are for that sort of scenario.
The ones in Mayor Park are quite interesting because there's no vehicular access to them, and a lot of people who have a lot of material as their hobby these days are really, really keen on having vehicle access. Interestingly, at Mayor Park, there's a piece of land adjacent to the park which could make a really good access for a lot of material that isn't part of the what's now a rather well-developed nature area. You know, the trees, for example, are about this size. So if that was cleared back, it would actually have a detrimental effect on the ecology in the area. So what we need to do about the Mayor Park is find some land where a lot of hearing can take place without taking the old allotment back to bare ground.
Can I just come back to the sense on most allotments, including Bellington, you have a brisk rule, most of you, from the car parking areas to your allotment. It's huge. There are plenty of car parking spaces in the two car parks owned by the council and there's parking outside in their park. So I don't really accept that argument. It's if you've got 150 yards, that's all you'd have to walk, which is a lot less than we walk to our allotment in Bellington Road. And you talk about the eco, that's wonderful. So why, when we asked you if we could have that as a forest school, did we never bother to even acknowledge it there? You can't have it both ways.
I'm sorry if I didn't reply to an email about forest schools, I really apologise. With regards to allotments at Mayor Park, more than happy to meet with you on site. It may be that some of the areas of flat grass may be suitable and easy for allotments.
Sorry, I think we've had meetings which have got nowhere, and I don't think we should be using grassed areas that families use to cut them, to take those away. It's only a small park. We have an allotment that from when it was closed has never been used. It is the wildlife consists probably mostly of rats and Japanese knotweed. Down trees. We've heard many reasons why nothing's been done. I thank you for apologising, but I would say to you, Mayor Park is missed opportunities, and I'm very concerned. A number of discussions and meetings the Friends groups and others have had with Wirral Council, and nothing ever transpires, and this I find very not acceptable.
Thank you for your feedback.
Okay. Tony? I was just wondering, Councillor Brame's question regarding the finances, we seem to have quite a large underspend. Yeah. Is it possible to use that to create community allotments on the sites where the allotments aren't being used? I think that could be a solution to more people being involved. You know, we're on the waiting list in the community, on a community basis. Thinking of what Councillor Rennie said as well regarding the incredible edibles, you know, that sort of initiative. I wanted to frame it around people living with disabilities who could get involved in that type of activity.
Large underspend this year
some of our sites do have disabled, we call them disabled pods, because it's a really small area where people obviously with disabilities can take on that plot, and it's much smaller for them to maintain. We do also have groups, schools, communities that also have plots, so we do encourage that as well. And each allotment site does have its own community plot where there's a number of raised beds where obviously people can get involved, and on some sites it could be up to 10 people, if not more, on the community plot alone.
Signal we amend, establish a PSBO for dog control on two measures. In cemeteries, the dogs should be under control, and that we clarify play grounds and facilities to be all play areas, muggers, multi-use game areas, and kick outs, which are against a form of performing mugger, which we should define. And that we would, if you like, enforce the measures through signage. We've already mentioned, that Kingdom are no longer here. We haven't got an enforceable solution anyway. So that we would introduce the PSBO with signage against these facilities, explain to people that it is prohibited or the dogs are in control in the cemetery.
Okay, before I invite questions at my discretion, I'm going to ask Rob Wilkinson, who is part of the Rural Good Dogs Want to Do Address Committee. Rob, I just want to come up and get my microphone to address the committee. You've got 3 minutes, Rob, is that enough to address it? Great, thank you.
Good morning, thank you, Chair. Thank you for the invite. I didn't know about this sort of 5 to 6, so excuse me if I'm a bit jumbled up. I've listened to one writer, and I wrote the proposal for the issue last week or before. The general consensus of the public is you've already got existing bylaws, but you don't use them. You've got the bylaws there just to enforce the fine with people for picking up dog foul, and you don't use it. It just concerns everybody that if you're not doing it, then why is it PSPO suddenly magically better? Because from what I understand the law, I was chatting to a solicitor last night on the dog walk, is that once you bring in the PSPO, you can't go back to bylaw, because one supersedes the other. You can work with bylaw, but you can't go back from it once it's so there's concerns over that. If I use one word there, which really, really rang huge warning bells for me, and a lot of people have commented the same, use the word incremental. Now, we saw incremental with Kingdom. We started off giving out fines for dropping fag ends, and then it was, oh, we'll give them this, we'll give them that, and it will continue and increase. Because, with great respect, you see it as a revenue stream. It's not about changing the way people are, because that's what needs to happen. It needs to change it. People need to be behind it. People need to back it. People need to support you. People need to feel like they're part of the community. The bit that I know we've got certain dog owners here, everybody knows it's a dog owner. We are a community. We want most dog owners, 98% according to Kingdom, are responsible. Two and on. So we have great concerns in the direction that you're going, because it seems very, very similar to the direction you've gone in the past, which wasn't taken on very well by the residents of Wirral.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. It's going to take a seat back there. Mike, I don't know if you want to respond to that before we take any questions.
Colleagues, just to be clear, what we're recommending seeking your views on is updating the play ground bylaw, which prohibits dogs to be in playing grounds, apart from obviously assistance dogs, with updating the list of play areas so dogs should not be in areas clearly not compatible for dogs, other than obviously assistance dogs. And then the other bylaw, the cemeteries currently prohibits dogs, but we're saying that should be relaxed to dogs are allowed in, but under control. Dog fouling is not mentioned in this proposal to you. That's something that we need to consider for another time. This is about updating the current measures when the bylaws don't work. The advice we've got from legal colleagues is that we cannot amend the bylaws. So the bylaw on cemeteries, for instance, means that we carry on prohibiting dogs. Cemeteries, when we don't do that, the dogs are in there. And I think your view perhaps was that people should be allowed in to go to loved ones' graves with their dog if that's what they want to do under control.
Okay,
fans that know in respect of dog fouling, nobody out there, irresponsible dog owners out there, do not take a blind bit of notice of a sign on the street lighting column. We've got markings on the pavement. Nobody takes any notice at all. And again, I think this is just part and parcel. I don't know, you know, call me an old cynic and yeah, okay, put my hands up to that. Proud to be an old cynic, but I think this is, I am cynic, but I tend to think that somehow, and correct me if I'm wrong, that this is just a backdoor in to getting PSPOs across Wirral. And again, perhaps you'll advise me if my thinking on this is wrong, but where would the scrutiny be if we wanted to extend some of those PSPOs? Would they come back to this committee, or is it just a carte blanche then, that I understand is it makes it far easier for the council, if that was the way they were minded, to just import in further PSPOs in areas? Because, as I say, it's a half report as far as I'm concerned. The parts that you're talking about, yeah, I fully agree, dogs should be kept on leads, not allowed in the play areas that are clearly designated here. But it's all the other that goes with PSPOs. If we're going to talk about this, I think we need to talk about it all together, collectively, for all the reasons, and quite like you say, dog fouling isn't even mentioned in this, and it's a nonsense, because that is the number one priority. I can't remember the last time, hand on heart, but the last time a resident got to send me an email, phone call, spoke to me in the street complaining about a dog fouling in open space, because they are responsible dog owners who go there. Usually, clearly there's a small minority, and they pick up after their animals. But the streets are strewn with dog fouling. We're not getting to grips with that at all. And clearly I think that both of them have to come in a composite report where we can look at it in all areas. But I do think this is a backdoor to the implementation of PSPOs, which we all know was not popular at all when that was first muted.
Just in terms of the signage, we're talking about it, type on the signage, sort of the arrangements for cemeteries and play areas. So I would hope most people, apart from the most, you know, determined, would see a sign prohibiting them from entering into a play area or putting their dog under control in the cemetery, and would adhere to that. So that's the response to those measures. I fully accept the dog fouling solution remains outstanding. It's something we need to come back to you on. But it wasn't part of this report. This is about clarifying and updating the bylaws. The dog fouling issue remains something that we need to resolve. And indeed, at your previous meeting, you amended the council's, or approved on the acknowledged the council's enforcement policy to change, and that's taken out robust stroke zero tolerance enforcement. So eventually, we will come back to you, we must come back to you with our recommendations for advising enforcement of dog fouling and other measures. It's got to come. You'll acknowledge that as well. That is a separate and further piece of work we need to do. This is about the bylaws, and I thought the dog work we need to update them.
Yeah,
it
was
again.
Just for clarification, sorry, my exposure to make the point, but just explain to me then if the PSPO was enforced for these areas that you mentioned in the report, is it easy to then amend the PSPO so it could cover further areas without coming back to a scrutiny committee or a committee of, you know,
the legislation, the way the framework works, is that we cannot add other measures in because we've that's all going to happen. But of course, any recommendations about that will come to you first, and then obviously up to cabinet. So we'll see how the update of the bylaws go, if that's the recommendation that we receive, and then we'll consider all the measures as fit. And of course, the first one is dog fouling.
Okay,
David. Tell me to reinforce the comments that Mike's made. Having listened to this debate here previously, and also listened to it in two constituency committees, I can honestly say the first one to do with the cemeteries wasn't a genuine attempt to meet the question which is raised, which is the person goes to see their former partner's grave and they've got a dog, can be taken in there, so we're allowed to take the dog in and leave. It's intended to be helpful. And the second one is, the way it was explained to me is that where we have new play areas being built, I guess the most recent one, we have new housing developments, the same as we said, like to me, if you've got a child and they contract something in a brand new play area, you're going to ask us, well, why didn't you use the current legislation to provide the same protections you've got? That'll be a fair comment and a fair question. And finally, if you want the reassurance that this wouldn't be extended to other categories of areas, then yeah, we're happy to reinforce my reassurance that if that were to be the case, then we'd come back to the relevant committees for discussion.
Thanks, Chair. I don't know if I've missed it or not, but what seems to be missing in the report and what was said by a member of the public is it's the enforcement, isn't it, of you know, if a dog owner goes into the cemetery with his dog or her dog and takes it off the lead, who actually enforces that? You know, who's on the ground? We used to have the park police in the olden days, if you like, park wardens monitoring public parks and so forth, and then we changed to Kingdom, where we have non-council workers under a council contract enforcing the public in what was considered to be an inappropriate way, and that was one of the reasons why the contract was cancelled. So who will be, I'm assuming that it will be council staff that will be enforcing or working with the public to make sure the bylaws are acted upon, but I can't see that anywhere in this report. And if that was the case, there would be an on cost to the council regarding employing our own staff to do the job that Kingdom were doing previously. And we're under budget pressures, as we rightly know. So, where's the budget part of this, if you like, you know? And if we're going to use our own workforce, where it goes on.
Okay, post Kingdom, there is no current enforcement solution. We've got people that have the ability, delegated authority, to issue things like FBNs, to expected notices on fly tipping, but not on littering and dog finding. These sort of issues. And as we've already reiterated, this that we're looking to enforce it through signage. That's not going to be perfect in these bylaws, but at least clarifies the position for everyone concerned. But as we've said, we need to come back to you with our considered recommendations for the enforcement solution going forward. That is highly likely to be an in-house provision, yes, which comes with a cost, and that's why we need to do due consideration. We have some internal workforce, it's not extensive, that are out there in the community, and there are other people that man facilities. We will need to utilise those sort of people eventually. And again, what I do stress, advisory enforcement, which is basically pointing the errors of people's ways initially, and then taking enforcement accordingly if there's not an appropriate response. But that's the sort of business case we're working on now. Currently there is not an enforcement solution that can carry out enforcement of dog fouling and littering.
Thank you, Chair. I think the council is in danger of really being caught by the problems it created last year. And we've moved from a situation where we were having zero tolerance, and now we've gone to zero enforcement. So we seem to have gone from one extreme to the other. I think we've got to find a way through this. I mean, the issue that really concerns residents is dog fouling on the footpaths and throughout our estates, throughout our wards. And that's the issue that they expect us to be dealing with. And, you know, Mike has said, well, you know, we're not dealing with that here, this is simply about the SPOs, and that's true. But I think we're shying away from the matter that, you know, people are really concerned about, to deal with something which is rather peripheral interest. Having said that, I do feel some of the comments of, you know, we've received some emails from the dog groups, it is a little bit alarmist. I can understand why they've come to that, because they saw what happened last year, and they're afraid that we're going to be some open news to go down that route again. I really do accept the assurances that that is not the intention. We're not going to any outside enforcement body to come and sort of use this as some kind of cash cow, because actually enforcing dog fouling is very difficult. Catching people doing it is not easy. And the two areas that we're looking at, you know, as David was saying, that seem very common sense things. People don't want dogs in K areas, and they might want to take the dogs to a cemetery. And those are two things that are fairly easy to deal with. The fact that there isn't going to be anybody initially enforcing it, obviously it is a weakness, but if you've got signs up, at least they can become self-enforcing. If you're in a play area with your kids and you see somebody else with their dog and you say, hey, you know, your dog foul on the playground, and there's a, well, there's nothing to say, I couldn't, is there? So it's very difficult, but if there's a sign up, they can say, well, there's a sign not meant to be doing it here. And so it can sort of help to educate and encourage people to behave more responsibly. So I'm not wildly enthusiastic about the scheme, but I can see it does actually have some sense behind it.
I think I made the point that we know the pressures aren't, we need to come up with a solution, and that dog fouling is happening now. It occurs constantly, and you're obviously getting concerns, and we need to come back to the committee.
First of all, I agree with what Lesley was saying, but I know Rob was as well, because I agree with everything he said there. I was going to ask the question about how we're going to enforce it. How worried about you? I mean, signage, go past our park where it says no smoking. You have to walk to a forest to smoke. Go down the Wirral Way where it says pedestrians have the right of way. And you say to the cyclist, excuse me, slow down, you get told to F off. You don't say, oh yes, you're right, there's a sign there, I'll not do it. It's useless just having signs. No one cares, no one pays any attention. Unfortunately, you've got to come up with the answer, and we have to have some form of enforcement. I don't know what the answer is, but yes, put signs up.
Sorry, Jeff, just on the case that we won't be purely talking about where you should and shouldn't be. I think at least, as Councillor Rose said, at least we'll clarify. And that is, I think, confusing to people, not least because the current signage in the cemetery says dogs are prohibited and dogs won't be there.
Jim?
So I was on this committee last year when there were dozens and dozens of people very emotional and agitated and passionate about not having a PSPO, and I haven't received a deluge of emails recently on the issue, and I assumed that there'd been, as promised, a whole process of consultation and negotiation with the dog walking community, and I'm hearing that, well, that's not certainly from one group. Can you tell me what the process has been from last year to here in terms of public voice and consultation consent?
Well, I understand there's been full dialogue with the Rural Good Dogs and others. The camp member in particular took a personal involvement in doing that. But the issue here is that we're recommending not the suite of measures that we perhaps talked about a year ago. We're talking about purely playgrounds and cemeteries and playgrounds issues. So there has been consultation, there was full consultation before, and with some of the key national organisations as well. We did that in 2018-19. This is about cemeteries and playgrounds.
Could you be a bit more specific how many organisations
have
consulted and how many responses came back?
I can provide that information. The organisations that we've been engaged with. I'll do that.
Signs would not sort of stop people doing it. I mean, it's been said that 98% of dog owners would do the right thing. And at the moment, we've got play areas whereby we can't put a sign up because we've got no bylaw, we've got no PSPO. So I feel that while the report doesn't go the full measure of what we'd like, it does go so far into fill a gap. And I would think that to not recommend the report going forward as acceptance, but with a sort of proviso that we expect more to be done, it would be a mistake. mistake if we were to say, no, we can't put these things up to protect players, they're not at the moment being covered.
I think that in most play areas which have the sign up, so that's every play area that we've got now, it's got a sign saying no dogs. Those are fenced in. Obviously those aren't fenced, there isn't that sign. And I think most people are dear gentlemen. I have said to my group before, we do have a problem with small dogs that you tie them to the railings and they go through the railings. But I think everybody understands the man going there. I don't think that's the problem. I appreciate and I think everybody's right, new play areas, if we can't put bylaws, then we have to put the PSVL. But if we're not going to actually enforce them, then we've got a problem. And I quite agree with what Andrew said over enforcement, and I would challenge anybody who walks on the Wirral Way to not agree with it. Because you load down by bicycles left, right and centre, who don't give a monkeys, and it's a polite answer normally to what you get when you say anything. I think it's got to be enforced, because otherwise new play areas come in with signage and people realise immediately that nobody's going to do anything about it. In a lot of play areas you could say, your dog's supposed to be on a lead outside, you might put it on a lead with children running around. But in some play areas, if you said that, you'd be fearful for your life. Because some play areas have been overtaken by people using them for the wrong reasons, and they're not play areas anymore, and that's a problem. So, I can't, somewhere in all tonight, because something else has come to light tonight that's on my mind, I don't think I took it all in, and I'm sorry, Mike. But you said we had staff. So why haven't we got staff that can go around the play areas? Because we know when, in the play areas I use, when the parks and gardens people are in, they do come and say to people, if anybody's got a dog, can you take the dog out? So that's thoughts of the Mayor Park and Mayor Vet Park. They will come and say that. So I think, obviously, we need staff. And I can't see, I would think that that would be really well spent in the greater scheme of things, to have staff doing things like that, employed by your own house with some clout. As for the graveyard, yes, I agree with that. So we've got two points. The two points we wanted immediately to be dealt with are being dealt with. But in a kind of way that I think those of us who've been around this for a bit are suspicious, Mike, because we don't trust some of us, and quite a few of us anymore, what's being said about these PSPOs. Because we've been to meetings, and we've been to scrutiny meetings, then we've gone to workshops, and various people, like the late Mr. Elkington, have told us something completely different about what they're going to do, irrespective of what we've asked to be done. So you've got to appreciate that we do have concerns. I think we all are happy with what's proposed, but not quite in the way it's proposed. And I take the point because I'm a dog walker, and I've never been asked my opinion, and a lot of the groups of dog walkers that I know haven't been asked their opinion. So I don't know who hasn't been asked. One group, it seems like. I know we didn't want to open it up into some major debate like we did last night. But I do feel on the next part about dog fouling, you've got to open it up, because it's not just dog owners, it's the people who are treading in the dog run and getting it on their brand wheels.
Chair, yeah, the enforcement of the cemeteries and playgrounds is in size, that's imperfect, but it's obviously, I think it would work to degree with it. The enforcement solution, which is needed urgently, is for things like dog fouling, isn't it? That's where we haven't got the workforce at the moment, or identified the workforce, or provided them with the appropriate delegation. That's what needs to happen. There, in theory, there is elements of workforce that we can train and we can delegate to them to carry out that sort of exercise. So that's what we need the enforcement for. And yes, it's just to qualify what I said to Councillor Bird. The further measures that come would obviously need to be in full consultation with the groups, dog owners and non-dog owners, obviously.
Okay, I've just got a few comments. So I agree with most of what's been said. I feel that these proposals don't address the issue of dog farming in the Borough. The biggest, nobody who's come to me and said, you know, in about cemeteries. I mean, how many people have been fined in the last 5 years for taking a dog into a cemetery? So it's not, so we don't need the Bible, so what's the point? How many people have been fined for taking a dog into a park in the last 5 years?
The point is that we want people to be, have their dog under control, and maybe actually that's our expectation.
But
just take the size down a little bit as well as that.
But is there an answer to that question? In the last 5 years, how many people have been fined for taking a dog into a park?
I'm not aware, possibly not, but I'll confirm that.
Exactly, so this is absolutely pointless. If we didn't enforce it when we had enforcement,